Boa noite. Agradeço novamente a presença de vocês. Nós vamos dar continuidade ao nosso curso Espectro Cinematográfico, que foi aberto com duas conferências do Felipe Alain Michaud, né, que também está aqui, né, presente. E vamos dar continuidade com o professor Stefan Andriopoulos, do Departamento de Letras Germânicas da Universidade de Colômbia. As pesquisas do Stefan Andriopoulos giram em torno de literatura, teoria da mídia e cinema, né, entre outros assuntos, e para nossa felicidade nós estamos lançando os dois livros do Stefan Andriopoulos, né, o Possuídos e o Aparições Espectrais. Não vou me delongar muito aqui, vou passar a palavra para ele, reiterando o agradecimento ao Museu de Arte do Rio, através da sua Escola do Olhar, né, que está nos propiciando, né, essa parceria com a UFRJ, e o UFRJ, via Programa de Pós-Graduação em Artes Visuais e Departamento de Teoria e História da Arte. E agora passo a palavra para o professor Stefan Andriopoulos. Obrigado.
Well, thank you all for coming, and it's an honor for me to be here today and to speak in this wonderful series with speakers such as Philippe Alain Michaud, who opened the series last week with his lecture and who's also here today. And I would like to thank the Museo de Arte for inviting me. And I met the people working here today, and I looked at the exhibition, and it's a, you know, I mean, the exhibitions are very powerful, and I would like to thank everybody at the museum who was involved in organizing this event. I would like to thank Contrapunto Editora, and especially Cesar Benjamin and Vera Ribeiro for their work on the books. And my biggest thanks go to Tadeo Capistrano, and he has done such wonderful work in organizing this lecture series and in organizing this collection of books in Artificial. And he has been a wonderful host and friend to me. So I'm extremely grateful to Tadeo for all he has done. And if I speak too fast or too quietly, I guess I do speak too quietly, so just signal to me if there's any kind of technical problem. And I will speak, I will give a talk about Caligari and Mabuse, and then we will have a lot of time for questions and discussion after that. Yeah. In February 1920, numerous posters appeared throughout Berlin addressing city dwellers with a forceful exhortation, "You must become Caligari." The enigmatic slogan, also printed in several newspapers, was soon revealed to be part of an innovative advertising campaign for a new film. The movie, directed by Robert Wiener, was just completing the last stages of production at the Decla Company. Immediately after its release, The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari was acclaimed a masterpiece of German expressionist cinema. Its plot, unknown to the public at that time, centered on a showman and hypnotist who forces a somnambulist under his will, compelling the docile medium to commit several murders. Is this a good speed? Yet on the posters and in the newspaper ads, no mention was made of the film's title, plot, or even the fact that the campaign was meant to advertise a film. Instead, only a hypnotic spiral and a note with the date and place of the opening night accompanied the mysterious command, "You must become Caligari." The almost coercive "you must" foregrounded and enacted the suggestive or hypnotic power of advertising, which was still a fairly new mode of shaping social behavior. Just a few years earlier, the American psychologist Walter D. Scott had described the influencing of human minds as the one function of advertising. According to Scott, a successful promotional campaign relied less on conveying information than on suggestion, a process that he compared to a that he contrasted to a mere proposal. For instead of appealing to rational faculties, suggestion was based on surreptitiously implanting an idea in a susceptible mind. As Scott asserted, and I quote, "The most perfect working of suggestion is to be seen under hypnosis. There is no possible criticism or deliberation, and so we have the extreme case of susceptibility to suggestion." In this conceptualization of advertising, Scott invoked the medical theories of hypnotism and suggestion as they had been developed in the late 19th century by the French physician Hippolyte Bernheim. Around 1900, however, hypnosis was not merely linked to advertising. Indeed, structural affinities also connected hypnotism with the emerging medium of cinema. Numerous films such as Georges Méliès' Les Magnétiseurs, Maurice Tourneur's Trilby, Louis Feuillade's Le Jeu qui Fascinant, Robert Wiene's The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, Fritz Lang's Dr. Mabuse the Gambler, Arthur Robinson's Shadows, A Nocturnal Hallucination, or Rex Ingram's The Magician enacted the ostensibly unlimited power of the hypnotist on the movie screen. At the same time, early theories of film described the new medium itself as exerting an irresistible hypnotic influence on its spellbound audiences. In tandem with Venus Caligari and Scott's psychology of advertising, many early 20th century representations of cinema appropriated Bernheim's scientific notions of suggestions and hypnosis. Notions that had been introduced to a German readership by medical researchers such as Sigmund Freud, Albert Moll, and Auguste Forel. And these people described cinema itself as a hypnotic medium. Bernheim, who was the leading figure of the so-called Nancy School, had affirmed that not only hysterics, but potentially everybody was subject to hypnosis. The neurologist Charcot and Gilles de la Tourette regarded hypnosis as a pathological disease of the nervous system. Bernheim, by contrast, conceived of hypnosis as a natural state akin to sleep. In a circular equation of hypnosis and suggestion, he wrote, "I define hypnotism as inducing a specific psychic condition of increased suggestibility. It is suggestion that generates hypnosis." The emerging rapport between hypnotist and hypnotized subject was alleged to constitute a relationship of unlimited power on the hypnotist's part. As Bernheim and numerous other physicians affirmed, the hypnotized subject functioned as a sort of medium who could even be compelled to commit crimes against his or her own will. Since there were no clearly verified cases of crimes committed under hypnosis, many medical researchers staged simulated hypnotic crimes in order to prove their possibility. Auguste Forel, who taught in Switzerland, described one such experiment in the following manner. I quote, "To an older man of good suggestibility whom I had just hypnotized, I gave a revolver that Mr. Höfelt himself had previously loaded with blanks only. Pointing to H, I explained to the hypnotized that the latter was a thoroughly evil person and that he should shoot him dead. With utter determination, he took the revolver and fired a shot directly at Mr. H. Mr. H, simulating an injured person, fell to the floor. Then I explained to the hypnotized man that the fellow was not quite dead yet and that he should shoot him again, which he did without hesitation." That's the moment when you regret you became a humanities person rather than a medical researcher doing this kind of experiment. In addition to Forel, many other physicians staged similar performances, all of this for the ostensibly scientific purpose of proving to the largely judicial audiences that hypnotic crimes were indeed feasible. One particular fear concerned the possibility of implanting in a hypnotized person the order to commit a criminal action long after waking from the hypnotic trance. Forel accordingly warned of post-hypnotic suggestion, in which, in addition to a crime and the time set for its execution, the idea of free volition was implanted in the hypnotized subject, causing the person committing the crime to believe in his or her own free will. As Forel put it, I quote, "One of the most insidious ruses of suggestion, however, lies in the use of timing along with implanting amnesia and the idea of free volition in order to prompt a person to perform a criminal act. That person then finds himself in a situation that is bound to create in him every illusion of spontaneity, while in reality he is only following the command of someone else." This belief in perfectly camouflaged suggestion thus produced the powerful paranoia that there might be an unlimited number of hypnotic crimes that could not be recognized as such. After the turn of the century, scientific interest in hypnosis was initially superseded by the emergence of psychoanalysis and a renewed concentration on physiology within medical research. But in the treatment of war neurosis and shell shock during World War I, hypnosis and suggestion had an unexpected resurgence. Forel's and Moll's medical treatises about hypnotism, first published in the 1880s, went through numerous new editions between 1918 and 1924. Simultaneously, the extraordinarily successful late 19th century literary tales of hypnotic crime found an equally popular sequel within the post-war literature of the fantastic. Although neglected by most historiographies of Weimar cinema, the intense medical debate about the possibility of hypnotic crimes was also constitutive for Wiener's cabinet of Dr. Caligari, which opened in February 1920 at the Marmor House in Berlin. The first frame of the film shows in a medium shot two men with parched white faces sitting on a bench. As if referring to his own status as a ghostly phantom on the cinematic screen or a cinematographic specter, the older man says to Francis, "They are ghosts, they are all around us." A woman dressed in white appears, gliding past the two men in a somnambulist trance. And here we have this screenshot from this opening frame. Referring to the almost spectral apparition, Francis calls her his bride, continuing, "What I have experienced with her is much stranger still than what you have experienced. Let me tell you about it." And the camera cuts to a film set built of papier-mâché, representing a small town with narrow winding streets. From the very beginning, the film emphasizes that the moving images on the cinematic screen are a simulation akin to a phantom or a vision. Furthermore, the internal plot is marked as the unreliable narration of Francis, who is at the same time one of the protagonists of his own story. The pronounced artificiality of the set, in which both frame and internal story unfold, undercuts realist conventions. Painted shadows, dagger-shaped windows, a pale sky against which bare trees stand out in bizarre shapes, these visual markers of instability create a cinematographic space of paranoia and distrust. In critical responses to the film, Wiener's Caligari was therefore instantly hailed as a powerful cinematic instantiation of expressionism. But the strangely distorted spaces of the film set also appear as a materialization of the visual hallucinations that Bernheim generated by means of verbal suggestion in his hypnotized patients, and as he put it, populating their imaginations with phantoms and chimeras. In a further reference to its own status as a spectacle, the film introduces the showman Caligari, who exhibits a clairvoyant somnambulist at the fairground in the small town of Holstenwall. Aside from freak shows and cabinets displaying somnambulists, the fairground was also the site of the early cinema of attractions, which often toured from town to town in a tent. And I will now show you a short sequence out of the film that takes place inside Caligari's tent on the fairground. So, displaying the somnambulist inside his cabinet, Caligari transposes Cesare from the state of lethargy into the state of somnambulism. The sleeper is represented as an automaton that obeys all expressions of his magnetizer's will. In a close-up, the camera shows the somnambulist's face as he slowly opens his eyes. Cesare's wide-opened eyes recall Hofmannsthal's stage direction from his drama Elektra, where Hofmannsthal writes, "Clytemnestra's eyelids appear exceedingly large, and it seems to be costing her a terrible effort to keep them open." The representation of Cesare's awakening simultaneously corresponds to Charcot's medical nosography of grand hypnotism, which emphasizes the sleepwalker's open eyes in artificial as well as in spontaneous somnambulism. The film cuts to a medium shot showing Cesare's complete body as he begins to move his arms and legs. The androgynous medium slowly steps forward like a puppet that is held by invisible strings. And under Caligari's suggestive influence, Francis' friend Ellen poses the question how much longer he will have to live. Till Dawn pronounces the clairvoyant medium. A chain of mysterious crimes follows, perpetrated not by the original suspect, but by Caligari's somnambulist medium, Cesare. Francis pursues the fleeing showman to an insane asylum, discovering with dismay that Caligari and the director of the institution are one and the same. While Dr. Caligari sleeps, Francis and three physicians from the mental asylum search the director's office. In a cabinet, they find a book on his special field of study. The title page is shown on the screen and reads Somnambulism, a compendium edited by the University of Uppsala, published AD 1726. Francis skims through the volume and comes across the following story, which is displayed on title cards in the film. I quote, "The Cabinet of Dr. Caligari. In the year 1703, a mystic by the name of Dr. Caligari, along with a somnambulist called Cesare, appeared at various country fairs in the small towns of northern Italy. For months, he wreaked panic in one town after the other. By means of murders that were always perpetrated under the same circumstances. For he compelled a somnambulist, whom he had completely forced under his will to carry out his monstrous designs." The story within the story seems to provide an explanation for the previous plot turns, and it appropriates the fantastical tales in which late 19th century medicine conjured the unlimited power of suggestion. Next to the scientific treatise on somnambulism, Francis and the three doctors find a diary in the director's office. In interspersed flashbacks, we are shown how the director of the insane asylum develops the compulsive idea to transform himself into the historical figure of Caligari. "You must become Caligari, an outer suggestion that is repeatedly superimposed in writing on the actual filmic image." Here we see the "Du musst Caligari werden," which visualizes what he sees. While writing in film is commonly restricted to the intertitles, it here intrudes upon the cinematic image, a visual demonstration of the power of the director's compulsive idea to produce sensory hallucinations and to determine his actions. The episode thus contains the nucleus for the advertising campaign that exhorted inhabitants of Berlin in the weeks before the film's release with the same slogan, "You must become Caligari." But the storyline of the director falling victim to an obsession can also be linked to Wilhelm Wallhut's novel Under the Spell of Hypnosis from 1897. Wallhut's text centers on the figure of Dr. von Hafner, who cannot stop pondering the question of whether a skilled hypnotist could force even the most virtuous person to commit the biggest crime. After the idea of resolving the uncertainty by means of an actual murder enters Hafner's mind, his constant dwelling on his sinister plan turns into an auto-suggestion which, like Caligari's compulsive idea, seizes control of his actions with compelling force, turning him into a criminal. In addition to these late 19th century tales about the unlimited power of suggestion, Venus, the Cabinet of Dr. Caligari, also adapts the strange spectacle of artificial hypnotic crimes staged by numerous physicians with blank cartridges and wooden daggers. Bernheim and Forel regarded these simulations as authentic proof of criminal suggestion. But the impossibility of enacting real murders allowed the opponents of the Nancy school to discredit the science of such fake crimes, Scheinverbrechen, as Sigmund Freud called them, by equating their theatricality with the cultural institution of the theater. The German psychiatrist Binswanger, for instance, insisted that such observations only demonstrated the success of puerile show pieces. But in Binswanger's view, these experiments did not at all demonstrate the plausibility of hypnotic crimes. I quote Binswanger, "A wooden letter is put in the hand of a hypnotized woman, and she is ordered to stab her alleged enemy. powdered sugar is used to poison beloved family members. The patients perform these actions with greater or lesser reluctance, both in actual hypnosis and under the influence of such criminal suggestions for a shorter or longer period after the hypnotic state has ended. These actions are invented crimes of whose purely theatrical significance the hypnotized persons are fully aware. No conclusion must be drawn from these experiments in regard to the possibility of real criminal suggestions. And this is the end of the quote. Similar arguments were also advanced by Gilles de la Tourette and others. Bernheim, in response to this, therefore conceded the theatricality of the staged hypnotic crime for certain somnambulists. But he contrasted those cases in which the somnambulist knows that he is performing a play to others where the somnambulists have no power to resist. In highlighting the issue of simulation, Bernheim succeeded in giving his opponent's argument an unexpected twist. He admitted that medical experiments could not transcend the status of artificial enactments since it was impossible to commit real murders. Yet, instead of concluding that the staged hypnotic crime lacked scientific validity, Bernheim pointed to a complex mode of simulation that actually confirmed his supposition of real hypnotic crimes. In these second-order simulations, as they were described by Bernheim, the hypnotized persons conceived of themselves as performing the suggested actions only for the purpose of pleasing the hypnotists. But despite their belief in their own freedom, they were actually incapable of resisting the hypnotic commands. In Bernheim's words, I quote, "There are many persons who imagine that they were under nobody's influence because they remember hearing everything. They truly believe that they were simulating, and it is sometimes difficult to convince them that they did not possess the freedom not to simulate." Let me just repeat it. "It is sometimes difficult to convince them that they did not possess the freedom not to simulate." This perfect immunization enables Bernheim to reveal the deceptive semblance of freedom as a simulation of simulation. The status of simulation thereby becomes all-encompassing. The hypnotized subjects do not possess the freedom not to simulate. It therefore becomes impossible to decide whether the staged hypnotic crime is only a drama devoid of any scientific value or, on the contrary, authentic proof of the possibility of real criminal suggestions, a proof that paradoxically consists of a second-order simulation. This undecidability becomes a structural feature of Venus Film. Its closing scenes reveal the narrator and protagonist Francis to be an inmate of the insane asylum run by the Caligari figure. Francis' story may thus be the paranoid hallucination of a madman. This unresolvable conflict between frame and Francis' narration is, however, by no means an affirmation of totalitarian power, transforming an originally subversive or revolutionary screenplay into a conformist glorification of authority, as Siegfried Krakauer asserted in his influential study From Caligari to Hitler. Instead, the tension between frame and narrative functions as a meta-commentary on the medical fake crimes whose status as either authentic evidence or as scientifically worthless showpiece remains equally undecidable. The narrative structure of Caligari transforms the peculiar status that marked the medical spectacle of staged hypnotic crimes into a conflict between internal story and frame. Within the internal story, Caligari realizes the medical dream of the real, truly scientific experiment that ends with dead bodies and that must be regarded as unquestionable proof of the limitless power of hypnosis. In the diary, which Francis finds next to the scientific study on somnambulism in Dr. Caligari's office, the director of the asylum jubilantly praises the long-awaited admission of a somnambulist. I quote, Now I shall solve the psychiatric riddle of that Caligari. Now I shall fathom whether it is true that a somnambulist may be forced to commit acts that he would never commit in a waking state, that indeed he would loathe. Whether it is true that the sleeper can be driven to the very act of murder. Medical experts from the late 19th century were not able to determine with any certainty whether hypnotic crimes were possible because their scientific experiments could not transcend the status of simulation. As Bernheim put it in his lectures, you see how divided opinions are at present on this fundamental question, which for all too obvious reasons has not resolved been yet by a decisive experiment. The director of the asylum, by contrast, conducts a truly decisive experiment by compelling Cesare to commit real murders. In this manner, Dr. Caligari implements the kind of real-life experiment that had long existed as a paranoid fantasy of the neurologists and even underpinned the strange interpretation of an accident at the Parisian hospital of the Salpêtrière. When Gilles de la Tourette was attacked and seriously injured by a female patient in 1893, a rumor immediately circulated that the incident constituted a real hypnotic crime designed to prove to the skeptic Gilles de la Tourette that criminal suggestions were indeed possible. The Zeitschrift für Hypnotismus wrote, "The assassination attempt committed against Gilles de la Tourette has given rise to a great variety of commentaries. It has been said that our esteemed colleague was the victim of a criminal suggestion intended to convince him of the possibility of the realization of similar suggestions." But the absolute proof of killing for experiment's sake enacted by Caligari in having the municipal secretary and Ellen murdered by his somnambulist medium Cesare is called into question again. Frame and internal narrative denounce each other as paranoid hallucination. The medical performance of the staged hypnotic crime oscillates between a simple and a second-order simulation. Similarly, Wiener's cabinet of Dr. Caligari leaves open the question as to whether Francis or Caligari is insane. Francis' assertion of his own sanity is no less credible than the director's assurance that he will cure his patient. The conflict between frame and narrative, which mutually contradict each other, cannot be resolved in favor of a coherent interpretation that would efface this structural uncertainty. The undecidability that marks the medical spectacle of hypnotic fake crimes is thus transformed into a conflict between internal story and frame. In addition, the film's paradoxical narrative structure can also be read as a reference to cinema's suggestive power, which is enacted even more compellingly in Fritz Lang's Dr. Mabuse the Gambler from 1922. Lang's Dr. Mabuse explicitly comments on the parallel between the visual simulations of cinema and the hypnotic production of visual hallucinations as practiced by Bernheim and others. In the first part of the film, Mabuse, in one of his numerous disguises, gives a lecture titled "Psychoanalysis as a Factor in Modern Therapeutics." In this lecture, Mabuse equates transference between patient and analyst with hypnotic rapport, affirming, I quote, "If I succeed in establishing the contact between physician and patient in such a way as to completely exclude all disturbing external influences, then I harbor the firm conviction that in the future 80% of all nervous diseases will be cured through psychoanalysis." A review from 1922 correctly pointed out that the film suspends, as it were, the differences among suggestion, hypnosis, and psychoanalysis. Yet Fritz Lang's perverse reading of psychoanalysis rightly shows that analytic therapy does not constitute the opposite of hypnosis. Instead, Freud himself considered transference, in which the patient's unconscious thoughts refer to the physician, to be the functional equivalent or counterpart to the hypnotic rapport. And already 25 years earlier, Freud had aptly characterized the tie between hypnotized subject and doctor as the medium's exclusive concentration on the hypnotist. However, the elimination of disturbing external influences renders not only the therapeutic effects of suggestion possible, Mabuse's employment of hypnosis for criminal ends is also based on an exclusive concentration which generates an overwhelming rapport between hypnotist and hypnotized subject, a process powerfully enacted in the fourth hypnosis scene of a film. In the course of a poker game, Mabuse here hypnotizes the disguised district attorney Wenk by means of a pair of Chinese spectacles and the magical formula Zi Nan Fu. And now we watch that sequence. In a shot, reverse shot, the camera shows Wang's stack of money, and in an iris shot, Mabuse's shiny spectacles before cutting to close-ups of Wang and of Mabuse. After this face-off, the camera assumes predominantly the perspective of Wang, with whom Mabuse establishes contact. And I'm not going into a detailed description of each shot now, but I would like to emphasize the extreme close-up of Mabuse's eyes that dominates Wang's and the spectator's field of vision completely. A point of view shot follows, showing Wang's hand of cards, and suddenly the words Zi Nan Fu appear in writing on top of the cards, similar to the compulsive idea you must become Caligari that sees possession of Dr. Caligari in Venus film. We then have another shot of Mabuse. The background around Mabuse's brightly illuminated head is gradually faded out. A powerful visualization of how Mabuse succeeds in eliminating disturbing external influences. Mabuse's piercing gaze is fixed on the camera while his head seems slowly to move forward in space, growing larger and larger until it takes up and controls the entire screen. The hypnotic command, "You take," appears as an intertitle that also increases in size and becomes progressively more compelling. Fritz Lang's reliance on point-of-view shots forces the viewer to identify with Mabuse's hypnotized victim. The cinematographic representation of hypnosis is transformed into a celebration of the hypnotic power of cinema, an effect already emphasized in the first reviews of the film after its opening night on April 27, 1922. Eugen Tannenbaum, for instance, wrote in the Berliner Zeitung, "Stunning too, the manner in which Dr. Mabuse's hypnotizing gaze forces not only his victims, but also the audience under his power." It is Lang's combination of point-of-view shots and close-ups that subjects the viewer to Mabuse's hypnotic gaze. In this manner, the film employs a specifically cinematic mode of representing the hypnotized subject's exclusive concentration on the hypnotist. An anticipation for this cinematic mode of not just representing, but enacting hypnosis is to be found in Louis Feuillade's Le Jeu qui Fascinant from 1916. At one point in the film, the narrative introduces the criminal Moreno, who is characterized by an intertitle as endowed with a terrible hypnotic power. Right before this intertitle, a medium close shot shows Moreno staring into the camera, directly addressing the audience with his hypnotic gaze. The shot lasts for a few seconds, but the subsequent hypnosis of Moreno's helpless victim is shown only in profile. In contrast to Lang's film with its extended point of view shots, Feuillade thereby precludes the viewer from identifying with Moreno's hypnotized subject. Lang's masterful representation of Mabuse's hypnotic power may have also responded to Hugo Münsterberg's call for a representation of hypnosis that in itself exerted a suggestive influence. In 1916, Münsterberg published one of the first theories of film entitled The Photoplay, A Psychological Study. And we will have another talk about Münsterberg in the lecture series organized by Tadeo and Hugo Münsterberg's lab by Giuliano Bruno later in the fall. In this study about the photoplay, the German-born psychologist who taught at Harvard University invoked the possibilities of a cinematographic representation of hypnosis that would hypnotize its audience. At the same time, Münsterberg conceived of the close-up as the cinematic equivalent to the mental act of attention. I quote, "Everything which our mind wants to disregard has suddenly been banished from sight. The close-up has objectified in our world of perception our mental act of attention." In similar terms, the French film theorist John Epstein remarked in 1921, "The close-up limits and directs attention." Yet Epstein went even further, explicitly ascribing to the intensifying agent of the close-up a hypnotic effect on the viewer. I quote Epstein, "A head suddenly appears on screen and drama, now face to face, seems to address me and swells with an extraordinary intensity. I am hypnotized." And this statement from 1921, 1 year before Lang's Mabuse came out, seems almost like a literal description of the sequence that we have just seen. A head suddenly appears on screen and drama, now face to face, seems to address me and swells with an extraordinary intensity. I am hypnotized. Drawing on Lang's Mabuse, the influential film theoretician Raymond Berlure has postulated a seemingly universal relationship between cinema and hypnosis, defining filmic representations of hypnosis as manifestations of a fundamental relationship between the cinematographic and the hypnotic apparatus. It is true that Lang's film points to a structural affinity of film and hypnosis. However, in appropriating contemporaneous medical theories of suggestion, the film testifies not to a timeless, but to a historically specific interrelation of hypnotism and the motion picture. For it is in the late 19th and early 20th centuries that the visual medium of cinema had a startling newness, allowing for an amplification of its alleged power and impact. Conversely, the medical debate about the power of hypnotic suggestion reached its peak around the same time, between 1885 and 1900, and then again in the years following World War I. In order to analyze the contingent but nonetheless mutually constitutive interrelation that links hypnotism and the emergence and cultural appropriation of cinema, we will therefore shortly trace an intermedial exchange among medical representation of suggestions, cinematic enactments of hypnosis, and medical conceptualization of the medium of film itself. Numerous medical texts from the late 19th and early 20th century relied on cinematic metaphors in describing the relationship between hypnosis and the waking state. In 1922, the physician Ernst Kretschmer characterized the mental processes taking place in light hypnosis and free association as a, quote, picture strip thinking. In addition, Kretschmer explicitly likened the reliving of past events under hypnosis to the viewing of a film. I quote, what the hypnotized otherwise only thinks, he now experiences pictorially. Episodes from his past are actually lived through in orderly, comprehensible scenes that correspond to memory. The mental experience unrolls like a picture strip, film-like, before him. In the 1880s, Bernheim not only anticipated these later comparison of hypnotic recall and film, but he also experimented with the hypnotic production of visual, film-like hallucinations. Bernheim conjured up passive hallucinations, which his patients perceived like the viewers of a movie. Although no material substrate corresponded to the suggested mental pictures, they were as clear as reality. Bernheim even claimed that the hypnotized persons saw the images with their very own eyes. The hallucinations engendered by suggestion took shape as a passive dream. The hypnotized person experienced the scene conjured up by his imagination without any bodily participation. As a second ego, he saw the suggested scenes while sitting motionless in his chair. Bernheim's hypnotic production of visual hallucinations evoked the setting of a movie theater where the viewer also sits motionless in his or her chair while being captivated by the moving images on the screen. It therefore seems almost inevitable that an equivalent hypnotic creation of hallucinatory cinematic vision is also enacted in the second part of Lang's Dr. Mabuse, the Gambler. There, Lang shows experiments with mass hypnosis, waking hypnosis, and trance conducted by Mabuse under the pseudonym of Sandor Weltmann. And we can look at that sequence now. This will be the... Thank you. Weltmann creates mass suggestions in the audience gathered for his experimental evening, which, as the intertitle tells us, are similar to the tricks of Indian fakirs. The collective hallucinations produced in this manner are perceived by the members of the audience as if they were watching a movie. Standing on the empty stage, Weltmann suggests to his audience the image of a tropical landscape that fills the unoccupied space in front of the seated spectators as a film screen. Mabuse, who stands to the right of the hypnotically generated screen, assumes the role of the film lecturer who in the first decades of cinema accompanied the projection of the moving images with an oral commentary. In representing the production of moving images by means of verbal suggestion, Lang's Dr. Mabuse the Gambler conceives of cinema as a form of hypnosis. The meta-cinematic commentary upon the hypnotic production of immaterial yet moving images simultaneously appropriated an extensive medical debate that described the cinematic apparatus as exerting an irresistible hypnotic influence. And I'm coming now to the last part of my talk about these medical accounts of film at that time. In the 1910s and 1920s, literary authors such as Cocteau, Hasenclever, and Musil invoked the, quote, collective hypnosis into which the cinema audience is plunged by light and shade. At the same time, physicians and psychologists also emphasized the photoplay's tremendous suggestive power. Hugo Münsterberg explicitly employed the analogy of the, quote, hypnotizer whose word awakens in the mind of the hypnotized person's ideas which he cannot resist in order to represent cinema's superiority over the theater. The German neurologist Robert Gaup similarly warned against the deep and often sustained suggestive influence of the new medium. I quote Gaup. The darkened room, the monotonous sound, the compelling nature of the exciting scenes that rapidly follow each other beat by beat, all of this puts to sleep any critical judgment in the receptive soul. We know that all suggestions are more deeply imprinted when critical judgment sleeps. This comparison of the cinema and hypnotic suggestion was also formulated by Konrad Lange, Albert Hellwig, Georg Cohn, as well as by Hans Buchner, whose treatise Under the Spell of Film described what he called cinema man as succumbing to the hypnosis of cinema. Max Prell's book Cinema similarly warned against, quote, cinema's mass hypnosis. One particular fear expressed in many texts of the so-called cinema reform movement centered on cinema's alleged power to incite criminal actions. Numerous medical researchers described the film spectator as the victim of a post-hypnotic suggestion that controlled his thoughts after leaving the movie theater. This anxiety seemed corroborated by a sensational child murder, frequently invoked as exemplary evidence for the pernicious influence of film. Albert Hellwig gave the first detailed account of the case in an essay first published in 1913 in the Medical Expert Journal. According to Hellwig, the 16-year-old field hand of a farmer in Borbeck, a small village in the west of Germany, had murdered the 4-year-old son of his employer in the fall of 1913 without any apparent motive. The perpetrator had always been kind to the child, who later became his victim. Suspicions of any sadistic tendencies proved to be unfounded. The culprit was furthermore very moderate in his drinking and equally restrainful in his sexual practices. He did, however, frequent the local movie theater once a week and occasionally even several times a week. On the days preceding the crime, the delinquent had thus seen a Western and a cinematic adaptation of the fairy tale Tom Thumb, films that were described as in certain telling details showing a striking resemblance to the circumstances of the crime. The investigating judge consequently reached the conclusion that these two films had, quote, exerted such a suggestive influence on the accused that unwittingly subject to their influence and without any other motive, he had killed his employer's small son, on whom he ordinarily looked with fondness when on the afternoon in question he found himself alone with his victim in the hayloft. The case history seems to anticipate current anxieties about the incitement to violence ostensibly emanating from new media such as video games or the internet. But the legal representation of film's hypnotic power invoked a contemporaneous notion of suggestion and hypnosis. The judicial opinion described the cinematic suggestion as controlling the spectators even after leaving the movie theater. This replicates Forel's previously mentioned warning against crimes committed after awakening from hypnosis. According to Forel, the particularly insidious ruse of such criminal post-hypnotic suggestion consisted in the perpetrator's belief that he or she was acting freely of their own volition, while in reality under the control of a foreign hypnotic command. The sensationalist case history of the Borbeck child murder thus shows with unusual clarity why crime and suggestion came to be the most popular subject of cinema, as the avid moviegoer Viktor Klemperer put it in his diary on April 18, 1921. For the filmic representation of hypnotic crimes appropriated not only a lively scientific, medical, and legal debate about the unlimited power of hypnotism, in addition, contemporaneous representations of the new medium itself were predicated on a structural analogy between cinema and hypnosis. This gave rise to the fear that the spellbound audience might succumb to the irresistible influence emanating from the cinematic apparatus. Just like Dr. Mabuse's hypnotized victims or Dr. Caligari's somnambulist medium Cesare. Thank you very much for your attention.
Sobre os poderes de sugestão hoje das técnicas cinematográficas, das salas cinematográficas, etc. Como você pensa hoje esses poderes de sugestão do cinema através, por exemplo, de tecnologias como close-up, que Mustermeck chamou a atenção, digamos assim, no início do século XX. Hoje, com outro regime de percepção da imagem em movimento, com outro modo de se apreender o cinema para além desse dispositivo clássico que o gabinete do Dr. Caligari representa. Bom, estou colocando essa questão, eu conheço a obra o trabalho do Stefan, e ele já aponta para algumas questões sobre este assunto em um outro texto sobre lavagem cerebral, brainwashing. Enfim, estou colocando essa questão geral mais para a gente iniciar o debate, ok?
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you for that question. And let me answer the question in two parts. I mean, first, when I speak about the current situation, I think what happens now is that we have these very small images on our cell phones that we carry around with us all the time. I mean, in the 1980s, 1990s, there was the trend to what was called ambient television or ambient moving images, where we had these screens in an airport or in a restaurant or anywhere, and we still have that. But now we have it even closer on our body. So I think what's very peculiar now about images is that they are with us all the time. But at the same time, I think that it's rare that we have exclusive attention or concentration on these images. I mean, we may have those, and then it may be possible to think about this in these terms of suggestion and hypnosis. But I think very often we have something like distributed attention or dispersed attention rather than exclusive concentration. So we jump from attention between the cell phone to something else and back and forth. So I think that I would be hesitant to describe social media and cell phones in terms of hypnosis. I think that it wouldn't help us understand the specificity of these new technologies. But to answer the second part of the question, I do think it is true that there have been other new media that were also described as hypnotic in the 20th century. I mean, there was once radio emerged in the 1920s, people ascribed a hypnotic power to the voice of somebody speaking over these invisible airwaves. So it was a shift away from vision to sound, then suddenly as a medium that has an hypnotic effect. And then brainwashing in the 1950s, people were concerned about advertising, which was really, really widespread then in the 1950s, and then you have these texts that describe shoppers in the supermarket as falling into a trance, putting things into their shopping cart to buy things, and people talked about, so people in the period of brainwashing in the 1950s, people talked about advertising, television, and then widescreen cinema as a very new immersive experience, like Cinerama. That was a technology that's what is described as brainwashing, as a form of brainwashing or conditioning that had a very startling power again. So I do think that the newness of a technology, you know, these moments when there is something new emerging, it seems to generate this anxiety of being completely overwhelmed by this technology, and then people get more used to it and that anxiety dissipates to a certain extent at least. But I do think that that now in the 21st century, I don't think that hypnosis or suggestion are the categories which to think about how images affect us. That would be my first, intuition.
No testamento do Dr. Mabuse, o terceiro filme da série Mabuse do Fritz Lang, o filme sonoro. Uhum. Oi? Não. Os Mil Olhos é o quarto. Bem, aliás, bem lembrado, né? Mas eu estou falando do filme dos anos 30, né? Uhum. O Testamento do Dr. Mabuse. Uhum. Eu tenho um psiquiatra, uhum, que é hipnotizado pelo Dr. Mabuse já falecido, uhum, né? Se eu me lembro bem da história do filme. E como é um filme já sonoro, o meio, né, de hipnotização é a voz do Dr. Mabuse, né? Se eu me lembro, o psiquiatra lê os diários do Dr. Mabuse já falecido e a voz do Dr. Mabuse que efetiva, né, o processo de hipnose. A minha pergunta é a seguinte: essa questão da relação entre hipnose, cinema e psicanálise não passaria, sobretudo, pela questão da voz, daquilo que os psicanalistas chamam de voz como objeto, que é correlativo ao olhar como objeto que a gente já vê no primeiro Dr. Mabuse, na sequência que o senhor mostrou para a gente agora há pouco? Quer dizer, essa questão do sonoro, da dimensão do audível no processo de hipnose, não teria ficado, digamos assim, escamoteada na história do cinema pelo fato de que o som só aparece tardiamente? E nesse sentido, a chave dessa questão não estaria no terceiro filme da série Mabuse, no Testamento do Dr. Mabuse? Uhum. É isso.
I will thank you for the question, and I will try to go slowly for the simultaneous translation. So yes, I think that sound and the voice have always been present in the history of hypnotism, and there are very many different ways of inducing hypnosis. So it doesn't have to be shiny glasses, you know, but you can also just generate hypnosis by speaking. Bernheim even hypnotized patients over the telephone in the 1890s already, and Münsterberg did that too. So the sound as a transmission or transmitter of hypnotic commands was present in the history of hypnotism from the very beginning. I focused on the close-up in this talk because that was the very specific concern of, I think, especially Dr. Mabuse, The Gambler, that film. And we have a few close-ups in Caligari, too, that are already very powerful. And speaking about the testament of Dr. Mabuse, I agree with you that we do see the loudspeaker and the phonograph in key scenes of the film. It's mechanical media, mechanical sound media that transmit the orders of the person who carries out Mabuse's legacy or will. But there's also, as you said yourself, he does read Mabuse's diaries. The Dr. Baum, I think is his name, Dr. Baum, he reads these diaries, and then he starts falling victim to the compulsive power of these diaries. And it's the power of writing, like a very strange kind of writing that Mabuse does, that is displayed there. And I think that when looking at the testament of Dr. Mabuse, which is a film from 1932, it was forbidden by the Nazis in 1933 in Germany, was not allowed to be shown. I think it's a film about propaganda, actually. So I think it's very much about the what you could call the hypnotic power of propaganda, but it's not so much psychoanalysis or hypnosis in Bernheim's or Freud's sense, but I think it's really about propaganda and how propaganda can have this power. And I think that there is that's the specificity or the specific timeliness of that film in 1933, The Testament of Dr. Mabuse. And I think that, you have this strange power of Mabuse's ideas, like they're just written down, but then this other person reads them and they become... These ideas have their own power and agency almost. And I think it's advertising, but even more propaganda, I think, that this film is focusing on.
Boa noite. Mm-hmm. Gostaria, assim, uma curiosidade, gostaria de saber de você o seguinte: quais elementos você poderia, assim, sugerir, ou então, enfim, nos apresentar de hipnótico, subliminar, que um cineasta venha a utilizar no seu trabalho para poder captar aquela emoção que ele quer expressar? Por exemplo, a gente hoje está em diferentes, como já foi mencionado, né, nós temos diferentes janelas, formatos, meios de produzir filmes. E além do que já foi colocado aqui, né, o close, desenho sonoro, enfim, assim, na sua percepção, assim, qual um elemento, assim, que você sugere, assim, interessante de você colocar uma mensagem subliminar, além do corte, enfim, isso é uma curiosidade minha.
Uhum. I'm not sure whether I understood all of the question, but let me. I think the close-up is something.
Deixa eu só repetir. Mm-hmm. Deixa eu resumir. Então, mm-hmm. Uma curiosidade, mm-hmm. Pela sua experiência nesse estudo, né, do cinema e da hipnose, dessa relação da pessoa que produz o filme, que faz o filme, com o espectador, essa relação da hipnose, da mensagem, hoje, no filme contemporâneo, produzido hoje. Para alguém, qual um recurso que para você lhe traz uma certa interesse e até curiosidade de poder trazer essa mensagem subliminar a partir do momento que a gente vive, uhum. num momento disperso de diferentes formatos e meios de janelas e de produção, né? Assim, qual o recurso, além do desenho sonoro e além do close? Qual elemento, assim, você vê que traz esse poder hipnótico do espectador, do cineasta com o espectador?
Uhum. Okay, let me try to answer. I think that the close-up is very specific to the 1920s. I think if we look at close-ups now, we are so used to close-ups now that they have still a power. It's still something very amazing to see a close-up and to see a face 4x4 meters. You know, like it does have a intense. You know, like it does have an intense appeal to us, I think, still. I'm not sure whether I would use the word hypnotic in relation to the close-up today, but I think when the close-up is still a fairly new filmic device or mode of representation, it certainly is described in these words. And similar with sound, when sound is, you know, when the transmission of sound is something very new, people, you know, a disembodied voice rather than the voice of a person who has a physical body, who's physically present, a disembodied voice may have a certain, it may have a certain uncanniness to it that may be startling and that may be described also as that voice having a hypnotic power. I do think that today, what we really deal with today is specifically to film. I think that films are. I think that maybe one would shift to the term immersion rather than hypnotic. You know, like an immersive media. I mean, you can describe a history of immersive media over a long period of time. And when you sit in a dark movie theater, I think it's still a very immersive experience. But I think it is, of course, true that cinema is no longer just in the dark movie theater, but cinema is on the iPad, and it's cinema. You know, it's like, I mean, film is no longer the same. Like it has moved out of these dark spaces into our everyday life, and there these moving images have a certain, I would describe it as ubiquity, and what I think is just the, you know, when you think about the cell phone, you know, like it's something that is very close to your body, and it's almost like, I mean, when you own one and you're used to it, when you leave a table and you don't have it in your pocket, it's almost like a little part of your body is missing. Like I think that closeness to your body and the ubiquity of it is what I would describe as the most powerful quality of that medium. I don't think I would describe it as a hypnotic one, though. I'm not sure what, I mean, I'm not a theorist of new social of new media right now, but I think that this effect on the body is one thing that one would have to emphasize, and I do think the fact that it's all the time with you is something that one would have to emphasize. I mean, Jonathan Curry, he describes in 24/7, he describes the moment where we are asleep as the only moment where we escape the interpolation of these media. And then he talks about people who wake up in the middle of the night to check their email, and which is luckily not what I do. But I think it's this being hooked to it all the time, you know, like in the same way as you breathe, you read these messages, and when you're on the phone, you don't, you know, when you, like, so you say you're on the plane for 10 hours, you are cut off, like it's this physical thing of being linked to it, I think, that I would describe in that term. And I think that it's a very corporeal, physical effect that way. So,
I have the feeling that there is a sort of historical break between Caligari and and Mabuse, and not only stylistically, but in the way the hypnosis is understood and conceptualized. Don't you think that the hypnotized is not in the same position in Caligari and in Mabuse? In Caligari, I have the impression that the hypnosis is a way to describe ontologically what an actor is. The hypnotized is in the position of the actor, And in Mabuse, it's a question, it's a political question. And it's a way to describe the audience and a way to manipulate the audience. And then there is a sort of shift to a political question between in the space of 4 years. And it's not, it's an ontological question in Caligari, and it becomes a political question in Mabuse. I don't know if you would agree with this.
Well, thank you for the question, and I have to think a little about it. I do think there are clear differences, but there is also certain continuities, right? I mean, you have Du musst Caligari werden, you must become Caligari. And then you have these writings in Mabuse. You have it seen in Fuyo. There's another sequence that I didn't show where Mabuse's hypnotized subject sees these writings as exactly like in Caligari. So I think there are certain continuities, but there are clearly differences. And it's interesting to think about what does the hypnotized subject stand for. That's the, you know, I mean, your suggestion that the hypnotized subject stands for the actor in Caligari and it stands for the audience in Mabuse is an interesting one. And I do think it's certainly true that Dr. Mabuse, the gambler, creates a parallel between the subject and the audience in a very explicit way. I do think that in Caligari, the audience, though, is also addressed by the narrative structure of the film, because the audience somehow has to, it believes Francis, the internal narrator, for 86 minutes. We believe everything we see when we see the film the first time. We believe the story of this person, and then suddenly we are told he's insane, and that creates a conflict in the audience. So there is a certain addressing of the audience in both. And I mean, in this short lecture, I also emphasized in Mabuse, especially those moments where the audience is overwhelmed by the film. But there is also then that moment where Wenk says no, where Wenk is able to break the hypnotic spell of Mabuse. So there are those moments where the power of the hypnotist is not, you know, it's overwhelming, but then there are moments where the film shows a limit to this power. I think there are clear differences. I'm not sure whether I would describe one film as more political as the other one. I think that Dr. Mabuse, the Gambler, is very clear, is very explicit in its references to political developments that happen at the time. Speculation is shown, inflation is shown, counterfeiting and all of that. Caligari projects its story into the 17th, like it's an old story, it seems. It's not a modern setting. It's not a modern city. But I think that both films really, I'm not sure whether Mabuse the Gambler, you know, has a political interest, really. I think that The Testament of Dr. Mabuse, I would agree, that is a very political film. I think Dr. Mabuse the Gambler, it describes itself as a document of its time. It wants to show contemporaneous Berlin in 1922 and modernity, and it's very timely in that way. But I don't think that Lang pursues explicitly political, that there is a lot of, like, I think there is, you know, if there's a political dimension, I would describe it to both films rather than just to one, I think. And I do would like to resist, you know, clearly, and that's not what you said, but I would clearly like to resist this Krakauerin, you know, Krakauer's interpretation that just looks at both of these films as somehow anticipating Hitler, who really comes 10 years later. And it's not true that these filmmakers had a prophetic power and could foresee the rise of Hitler. I think that, again, they are in The Testament of Dr. Mabuse. There are very clear allusions to Hitler in the way how Baum speaks, like he gives these very historical speeches where he makes gestures that almost look like Hitler when he talks about the genius of Mabuse. And but I have to think a little bit more about this question of focusing on the actor or the audience. I think that there is clearly a stronger and more explicit addressing of the audience in Mabuse. I would agree with that.
Boa noite. Eu lembrei do primeiro, em primeiro lugar, do conto que você trabalha no seu livro, que você cita, O Orla, de Maupassant, e depois de Nosferatu, do Murnau, de 22, como relações vampíricas que também trabalham a questão da hipnose. A minha pergunta, na verdade, não chega a ser uma pergunta, mas é para comentar como que esse poder hipnótico do vampiro aparece, principalmente em Nosferatu, de 22. Eu estou perguntando porque é um filme que eu sei que você gosta, e eu sei que essa relação da hipnose, o sonambulismo e o espectador acaba se tornando também sugestionável, está presente nesse universo.
Thank you for the question, and I think, I think that it's true that in Maupassant's Orla, and in it's very much about hypnosis, and in Bram Stoker's Dracula, in the novel, you have, Mina, she's the female secretary, she is hypnotized by Van Helsing, and there are clear references to hypnosis. I'm not sure whether I would talk about Murnau's Nosferatu in relation to hypnosis. I think Murnau's Nosferatu is a perfect film for the cinematographic specter. It's a film that very much talks about the cinematic image as a ghostly phantom or as a spectral projection on the screen, and there is a clear affinity between this immortal and at the same time immaterial diaphanous creature Nosferatu and the cinematic image on the film strip. And so I think that Nosferatu is a film that clearly speaks to the history of the cinematographic spectre, and also to certain anxieties about the immortality, about of these recorded images, and how the immortality of these recorded images may subtract life force or lifetime out of the recorded subjects. There are contemporaneous texts that describe there's this text by Pirandello where he describes the camera as a kind of vampire, and Serabino, this fictitious cameraman Serafino, I forgot the second name now, but he talks about how he films people, and by filming he reduces them to insubstantial phantoms, and he becomes the executioner. And it's a very, and he talks about the camera, the tripod of the camera, as having spider legs and it being like a vampire almost. So I think there is this anxiety about cinema as a kind of empiric medium in the 1920s. I think that it's close to, and there are some overlaps to, the anxiety about cinema as a hypnotic medium, but I don't think that the vampires are necessarily hypnotic. And I think that in Murnau's Nosferatu, I don't see much of an interest in hypnosis.
Bom, eu gostaria de falar dos seus dois livros. É interessante que pensar a hipnose significa também pensar essa ambiência cinematográfica, que significa isolamento num ambiente, num espaço escuro, e uma atenção focalizada para um ponto luminoso, digamos assim. E Possuídos, o seu livro gira em torno da hipnose, para pensar então esses supostos poderes de sugestão, né, do dispositivo cinematográfico através de Caligari e Mabuse. E é interessante que
O seu segundo livro, Aparições Espectrais, você utiliza figuras epistêmicas através de mídias, né, visuais, como a fantasmagoria, né? E o último capítulo de Aparições Espectrais, Televisão Psíquica, existe uma figura epistêmica, que é, como você menciona, né, figura epistêmica, que é a televisão. E é interessante que pensar a fantasmagoria ir, digamos, por uma certa continuidade. O cinema envolve essa situação hipnótica, escuridão, isolamento e concentração em um ponto luminoso. Já a televisão, ela evoca, né, uma outra relação para o espectador, que é uma relação não apenas hipnótica, mas, sobretudo, telepática, né, que vai, digamos, se consolidar hoje com esses dispositivos de conexão. Então, talvez seja possível pensar o espectador hoje mais nessa chave, digamos, da telepatia, que também significa se conectar com diversas frequências, eletricidade, onde a luz, a conexão é mais presente, né? E a escuridão, digamos, cada vez se perde mais a partir dessa experiência de recolhimento, introspecção e concentração em um foco. Então, lendo seus livros, isso me veio essa ideia da hipnose e da situação hipnótica e da situação telepática. Eu não sei se isso é uma sugestão sua ou uma interpretação que eu e mais alguns colegas estamos tendo. Então, se é possível você falar um pouco disso, dessa relação entre a hipnose e a telepatia, pensando essas mídias que você analisa como figuras epistêmicas, né? A fantasmagoria, uhum, o próprio cinema e a televisão.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you for the question. And I mean, there are different ways of answering the question, and there's a lot of continuities between the books. Obviously, I mean, there's an interest in the ghostly, in possessed already to a certain extent, and there is still. There's one chapter one chapter that deals with E.T.A. Hoffmann's The Magnetizer, which is very much about the compelling power of one person over other persons, which is from the 1810s, this text, but it anticipates these, it's very similar to the anxieties about the unlimited power of hypnosis around 1900. And so I think that you know, there are similar interests in both books, and the main part of spectral apparitions is about 1800. There's then that final chapter about television, but otherwise it's about 1800, and that would be one way of answering the question. In a historical way, I could answer your question that in mesmerism or in animal magnetism, as it is called in the early 19th century, in the 1810s and 1820s, there's telepathy and hypnosis are both, I mean, that those are not terms that have been established and have been defined, but these processes are described as processes that are induced by animal magnetism or by mesmerism. And there's no clear differentiation or distinction. And it's in the 1880s that spiritualism and hypnosis differentiate. I mean, there are some people who do both, some scientists and researchers, but there are others who say hypnosis is science and spiritualism is nonsense. I mean, Hugo Münsterberg says hypnosis is science, but spiritualism is nonsense. It's not proven. That's so they, you know, there are these people who try to really differentiate these two, and so I think around 1800, if you think about the history of science or the history of knowledge, around 1800 in mesmerism or animal magnetism, this is still one way of thinking about these phenomena, and then this differentiates over the next 100 years, and then you have a very clear distinction between hypnosis and telepathy around 1900, and that epistemic distinction then you can also describe as telepathy then is used to talk about radio or television more, whereas hypnosis is more used to talk about the effect on the listener or viewer. So the effect, the moment of transmission, that's what when people talk about telepathy, you know, when they use those categories, when they talk about transmission media, whereas they refer to hypnosis or invoke hypnosis when they talk about the effect on listeners or viewers in the period, I think. So television can be thought of as a telepathic and a hypnotic medium in the 19, you know, at certain moments, because it has this wireless transmission from one place to another, which is like telepathy. But then the person sitting in front of the screen in his or her dark living room may be hypnotized by the device. And but I think it's just a differentiation of these scientific and pseudoscientific or parascientific discussions and discourses that leads to that.
Si todo lo que estás hablando no tiene que ver también con una teoría de la atención, porque hay algo del orden de la atención.
So simultaneous translation heard attention, but the beginning of the question. But so I mean I could I think it, I mean Jonathan Curry has written a large book about attention, suspensions of perception, and that would be a book to look at when it comes to the history of attention. I do think that there is a lot of overlap between attention and hypnosis around 1900, and I think of Possessed as, you know, I mean, it's a book that describes a very similar moment or something very similar to what Jonathan Curry describes in Suspensions of Perception. You know, it's the same time period, late 19th, early 20th century. And I think that the scientific study of attention, as Curry has shown, becomes really a subject of scientific study at the time. And a regime of attention is instituted. I think that today we are in a different regime of attention, and we no longer have, you know, sometimes we may still have exclusive attention, you know, pure concentration on one thing, but we much more often have now a training of having distributed attention to different things at the same time. So we are expected to be on our, you know, like to be responsive to not just one thing exclusively, but to several things at the same time. But once you are no longer in the realm of exclusive attention, it doesn't make sense to talk about that as a state of hypnosis, I think. Because I think hypnosis is really traditionally described as this moment of excluding disturbing or external influences, and that you have this exclusive rapport between hypnotist and hypnotized subject. And I think at the moment where I have distributed or dispersed attention, it's somewhat different. That doesn't mean that I'm necessarily in a state of freedom when I have distributed attention. It's just possibly a form of manipulation or a regime that we are subjected to that functions differently than one that asks for exclusive concentration. I hope that answers the question a little.
In hypnosis, there is a hypnosis, yes. The sleep. So maybe also the dream, and maybe the way the cinema of the 10th and the 20s has employed the topic of the hypnosis is to describe the film as a sort of artificial dream. Mm-hmm. That there is a question of I wanted to ask you about the question of dream mm-hmm. and film.
mean, there's a lot of work about the dream and film, as you know. I mean, Metz has done a lot of this work, and it's powerful. It works well, you know. I think that, you know, when you think about, I mean, there's this one film which is very didactic and which I'm not really fond of, but which is also very much about this Secrets of a Soul by a Pabst. You know, it's a film, you know, that tries to, you know, adapt psychoanalysis as a pedagogical project. And then we have the dream sequences where you have a lot of superimposition, is what he uses. He uses superimposition in order to cinematically visualize dream work in that film. I do think that you can work with that, and I think you can describe certain things with that analogy or with that juxtaposition. I do think that it doesn't take away I think that hypnosis is in a way broader than dream. I think that dream, I mean, the people who describe film and dream, they typically focus just on Freud. And I think that the, you know, these authors that I deal with in Possessed, Forel, Bernheim, and so on and so on, and of course Freud did translate, I mean, one thing one should say, Freud did translate both Bernheim and Charcot into German. His first books were really translation of these hypnotic medical textbooks. But there are lots of other authors. So I think that if you think about the history of science, it's actually a much broader discussed topic than the dream, I think, hypnosis at the time. And I think that would be, so it would be a very historical way of answering why am I more interested in hypnosis than the dream would be really that. That would be the reason, because I'm not just dealing with one author and then Pabst or the Surrealists or, you know, but it's really a mass cultural phenomenon to a certain extent. And I think that the fact that there are so many different authors who talk about cinema as a hypnotic medium or who describe then, you know, like the pervasiveness of these analogies is something that I would think distinguishes, or that is something that the analogy between, or the affinity between cinema and hypnosis has over the affinity between dream and hypnosis. That's what I would say. But that doesn't take away from the validity to compare psychoanalysis and cinema, which emerge at the same time, and dream and cinema. But it's something that has been done very well by other people. Mm-hmm. And that's what I would say.
Mais alguma questão? Não. Bom, eu gostaria de convidá-los para uma segunda conferência do Stefan Andriopoulos amanhã às 17 horas na sala Celso Lemos do Instituto de Filosofia e Ciências Sociais da UFRJ. É uma palestra que vai ter a palestra se chama A Lanterna Mágica da Fantasmagoria, Espectros de Kant. Hoje, essa conferência do Stefan Andriopoulos girou em torno do livro dele Possuídos, e amanhã essa segunda conferência ela é a partir do Aparições Espectrais. É, gostaria de agradecer imensamente a presença do Stefan aqui. A conferência dele abriu também para questões que nós vamos trabalhar nas outras conferências, e todas as questões dos efeitos hipnóticos, das tecnologias sugestivas, da imagem de movimento, isso vai retornar. E gostaria de parabenizá-lo e agradecer vocês também pelas questões. Muito obrigado.